Hi, everyone. Welcome to Bloomberg. We're going to get started with our program this evening, but before we begin, I just would like to give a special round of thanks to our friends at the OPC and the Ford Motor Company, and also Madam Ambassador. And we also have someone in this room who has a birthday today. And it's up to you during the coffee hour after the panel to find who that person is. She is a woman, and she is indeed here, and that's all I'm going to say. So seriously, we're here for a very, very, very important topic for all of us who care about news and care about the free flow of information around the world, and we're delighted, as always, to have everyone here at Bloomberg. With that, I'm going to hand over to Matthew Winkler, our editor-in-chief emeritus and a great supporter of our organizations here today, who's going to make some opening remarks. Thank you, Matt.
Good evening, and welcome to this very timely discussion on the protection of journalists on assignments where conflict, unfortunately, prevails and life is increasingly perilous. Our thanks to the distinguished panel that is here tonight, including the ambassador, and for sharing their busy selves and perspective with us. And also, I'd like to say, as a former board member, how appreciative we are of the Overseas Press Club of America and Ford Motor Company for their partnership in the support of journalists across the globe. Well, as everybody knows, during the past 2 years, killings, imprisonments, abductions of journalists have reached an all-time high. You know, a week doesn't pass that CPJ doesn't inform us of how difficult it's become. And these attacks obviously represent a fundamental threat to individuals who are professional journalists and also the profession itself. And the locally based journalists probably face the greatest threat. They suffer the vast majority of the murders, the imprisonments, and the abductions. And that's why it's essential that news organizations and journalists work together to protect themselves, their profession, and our role in our global society. At Bloomberg, we established the high-risk deployment support team to safeguard news employees in more than 150 bureaus and more than 70 countries, as well as every destination where our reporting takes us. And Chris Lawton, who is a key London-based member of that team, is here this evening with us. We also endorsed the Global Safety Principles and Practices, which is the worldwide freelance standards released earlier this year. And since the safety principles were unveiled in February, more than 80 organizations have signed on to them. The Overseas Press Club obviously played a crucial role in pulling together the standards and assembling the signers. And here's hoping all of us can learn from the insights of tonight's discussion. And with that, I would just want to turn the next part of this evening to our moderator, Lara Setrakian, who's the Chief Executive Officer of News Deeply, which co-founded in 2012 by her. And I should add, she's a Bloomberg alum, and welcome back. Thank you very much. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much to Matthew Winkler, to the OPC, to Bloomberg, to Ford, for bringing us here tonight. By way of introduction, my name is Lara Setrakian. I'm the co-founder of News Deeply. We deploy in-depth news and information platforms online, focused on issues that are underreported in the mainstream news cycle. We did start with our first platform, Syria Deeply, in 2012. Before that, had the honor and privilege of reporting from the Middle East for Bloomberg and ABC News. And it was really in that job that this topic took on a more personal meaning. In our profession, there have been people we have known, people we have loved, who've been targeted or killed for doing the work that they knew was right, work that was needed. 69 journalists killed this year, according to the Committee to Protect Journalists. What we often think of as being in the wrong place at the wrong time But to each of them, there was a reason they were there. They believed in being there and being in the thick of the story. They were there following a sense of duty and calling, not wanting to ignore the human suffering or the dangerous dynamics that the world would otherwise miss. To each of them, they were in the right place at the right time, just with the wrong outcome. They shouldn't have died. They shouldn't have been a target. They shouldn't be forgotten. And their killers shouldn't walk away with impunity. We're privileged to be hearing tonight from four fantastic speakers with very personal connections to this issue who have stood out and stood up for the protection of journalists worldwide. And I'm very humbled to be part of the conversation and able to convene it tonight. So let's start tonight with Ambassador Raimonda Murmokaite from Lithuania. You're a prolific diplomat. You have many issues on your plate at any given time, but you make this one shine. You put it high on your agenda. Why? I mean, why have you made this a priority personally? What brought you to it?
There are many reasons, I think. As diplomats, you know, it's never, it's a combination of what your government wants and what you would like to see happen. And I think it was a wonderful confluence of having your government desire to move ahead with regards to the protection of journalists, and we do have a history behind that. A more recent history is, linked to the Lithuania-chaired Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe in 2011, and protection of journalists was chosen as one of the topics. Because free access to information matter a lot. I think you can take whatever reasons you want. We come from the world, and that world is not that distant, where we had only one channel of information and one official, broadcaster, which told you how to see the world, how to see things, and what to think and what to do, and that's still happening in so many parts of the world, and that's terrifying to think that you cannot have, your own mind, you cannot make your own mind, and that you're dictated from morning to night how you should be, what you should do, what you should say, and what you should ignore. Freedom of expression is, and free flow of information is what makes us what we are, in a way, and to deny that freedom of information, that freedom of the expression, is something which, it's better not to know physically. Therefore, to make sure that, given where we come from, we can safeguard and protect and speak out for others to have that freedom, is very important to us. On a practical level, I remember very well when we declared our independence and Soviet Union at the time was still a thing of the present, and the whole difficulty of getting our voice across to the world. And at one time, the rumor spread that the Soviets, which, kick all of the foreign journalists out of Lithuania, and the fear that was there in the society at the time, thinking if foreign journalists are sent out, that's our own safeguard of protecting ourselves and to make sure that nothing happens to us. We had no better idea of how to protect ourselves except have foreign eyes on the terrain to make sure that they know what's happening and they can convey that message to the rest of the world. And I think so many people, what you do with Sira Deeply and the other projects, I think that's exactly the thing. People in the crisis situations, in terrible situations, where life means nothing at all, sometimes hangs on a little straw, and that little straw is information that you can broadcast as journalists, as freelancers, as bloggers. And in that sense, it's such a natural thing to stand for the journalists who do the job that I don't know what else could be as natural as that, because this is who we are on the one hand, but this is also what makes us, in some cases, what keeps us alive and what keeps us going.
The stories.
Yeah.
Joel, you used to tell the stories before you were at, when you protect journalists, you were daring journalists in very dangerous places.
I don't compare to the other people on this panel. I mean, I worked I started my career in Central America, in Guatemala, and I covered Mexico, and, you know, I had a few scrapes here and there, but, it was just a different time. I mean, that was the thing to keep in mind. A lot of the things that I used to do, I was a freelancer, and, I just go off and cover some story, and the thing that led me to do what I do as an advocate for journalists was this. You know, this was a time when, even though I was a scruffy freelance correspondent in Mexico, you know, I had this little card from the president's office that entitled me to be a correspondent, and, you know, man, like, roadblocks would disappear, and people would wave me into buildings, and I was treated in like an important person, even though I didn't feel like I was. And it was just the visibility and the power that went with being an international journalist at that time. And everyone here on this panel will recognize this, really what I was doing half the time was just regurgitating what my Mexican colleagues were telling me, because they knew the story so much better than I could possibly know, and they'd say, oh, you know, we're covering this, is a great story, and I would, like, kind of redo a lot of the reporting that they were doing, and they wanted me to do that because they were vulnerable. And sometimes bad things happen to them, and I used my position to speak out and defend them, and that's kind of what led me to do this work. But I mean, the thing that's just so dramatic is how different that, you know, that feeling of invulnerability that you had, that press pass, that magical thing that gave you this this sort of force field, that's gone. That is so gone. That is just a different era. We can talk about that in a moment, but that is it's just like a sort of a memory at this point.
What's changed?
Well, what's changed is the it's really a power dynamic, a relationship of power. People talk about the legal protections that journalists have, and of course those are important, and international humanitarian law, and that's important too. But the reality was that journalists were just useful. Journalists collectively exercise this information monopoly, not as individuals, but collectively. So no matter who you were, whether you were a criminal organization, some capo, or whether you were a government official, or no matter who you were, if you wanted to communicate with your society or with the world, you had to go through the press. So journalists were useful, and it was their utility to all sides that gave them this level of protection, and of course at the top of the heap were the international journalists. But they're less useful. I mean, it really comes down to that. People have all sorts of complex analyses of what's changed. But the reason journalists are less vulnerable is because they no longer exercise this collective information monopoly. All sorts of actors, governments, non-state actors, criminal organizations, militant groups, they have other ways of communicating. So they're not dependent on journalists. And so that power dynamic has shifted. And that is why we're seeing record numbers of journalists in prison around the world. Governments aren't afraid of journalists. And record numbers of journalists killed around the world. Criminal groups, militant groups, they're not afraid of journalists either.
I expected a different answer. No, in a good way. Just watching all the dimensions through which CPJ and you personally have worked on this issue in terms of impunity for killers, mm-hmm. What seems to be a lack of political will in some governments, even though this is a diplomatic issue now, the non-state actors, the extremely lucrative business of selling people,
sure.
Many of them journalists,
sure.
And you guys work on all those fronts,
right.
And I suppose this power dynamic has shifted every single one of them.
Exactly.
But just curious, tell us even a little bit more around,
how do we overcome this? Well, I mean, I think that the one thing you have to do is take a step back and just realize the complexity of the information ecosystem in which we operate today. The number of people who are participating in this process of gathering and disseminating information from, the most best equipped international correspondents working for major media organizations. And of course, there are fewer of them, but they're definitely still out there, and they definitely play a critical role. To national journalists for well-established media organizations within the country, to the fixers and stringers and support staff that support international organizations, to local freelancers, to international freelancers, to citizen journalists, to eyewitnesses with a smartphone. All of those individuals are participating collectively in this process of gathering and disseminating and sharing the information that we call news. And their vulnerabilities vary quite a bit. And so we need to develop responses tailored to these different constituencies and their different needs. You know, and I think that's what makes this environment so challenging. We can sort of get into the tactics, and I absolutely agree. We released this, just to give one example, we released our annual in-prison list. These are journalists imprisoned around the world. And, some of the there's almost 200 journalists. This is near record levels. Some of the countries that imprison journalists aren't that surprising. China's at the top of the list. It's been at the top of the list for a couple of years. But many of the worst jailers of journalists are allies of the United States. There are countries like Egypt, which is the second leading jailer of journalists, Turkey, Azerbaijan, Saudi Arabia. These are countries where the U.S. has significant influence. And it should be exercising that influence, and it should be saying jailing journalists is unacceptable in terms of maintaining a strong U.S. relationship. And in the instances where the U.S. has done that, it's produced results. We saw journalists, for example, released in Ethiopia in advance of President Obama's visit last July, because the U.S. government put considerable pressure on Ethiopia to take that action.
So much to talk about there. I'm excited to hear from Greg and Anna. And it, from what you're saying, Joel, for some reason my reference point personally is always the Lebanese Civil War for two reasons. One, it seems to be just an episode of history where we used to be shocked. We should be shocked when someone was kidnapped and shocked when someone was assassinated. But also in that same conflict, it was inconceivable in anyone's mind that a network would even close its bureau in Beirut. So this like dichotomy of being present and stable, but then also watching this danger scale move across to where we are today, where Anna and Greg have courageously and intellectually and wholeheartedly assigned themselves to cover places, Yemen so thoroughly in Greg's case, Syria and the Palestinian territories and elsewhere in Anna Teresa's case. And it's such a different picture now, and very little shocks us. Greg, you had really dedicated so many years to covering Yemen and then found yourself narrowly escaping a threat on your life. Can you share once more your story of what happened?
Yeah, sure. So I was working for BuzzFeed at the time, which does so much to protect us journalists in the field, a really great organization, and they certainly gave me a lot of support. And I went to Yemen with the idea of pursuing sort of three long-form stories. I mean, as journalists, as people, the world so often doesn't make sense. And we go and we're there on the ground and we're trying to put these different pieces together and we're trying to talk to people. We're trying to find this little corner of the world that we can look at, understand in some small way, and then convey that back to people in the United States or whoever's reading online or in print, just in a way that sort of explains this is what's happening and this is how it fits into the world. Because otherwise, I mean, the news is always coming at us. It's bombarding us with news of attacks here and attacks there. And so that's what I wanted to do in Yemen. And I had I spent about 3 weeks there. It was a country that I had been traveling to for about a decade, but it looked the same, but it had changed quite dramatically. The sense on the street that I had was a lot different. Just a few months before I went there, there was an American named Luke Summers who did freelance photography. Luke was kidnapped on Zuberi Street, and when I went there, he hadn't been found. He was somebody who had when the kidnappers came, they pushed him in the car, and he went in the car. And when I was there, he was still alive. There was another individual, a German diplomat, who tried to resist a kidnapping in the capital city of Sana'a, and the kidnappers chased him down and executed him in the grocery store.
And so, this was what year?
Both of these were in, the kidnappings happened in 2013, right at the end, and I went in 2014.
So this is the Yemen you knew becoming unhinged?
Yeah, it was changing so dramatically. I mean, the president that had been there for 33 years, he was gone. No one really knew, you know, before the Arab Spring, people had a sense of what the rules were. Like, you could do this, you couldn't do this. After the Arab Spring, everything changed, and you no longer knew what the rules were. And so right at the end of my trip is just sort of the one last story that I really wanted to grasp. A good friend who was my fixer, we went and we were buying an airline ticket for this guy to come up to the capital so we could interview him, because it was too dangerous for us to travel. And it was just a spur-of-the-moment thing. We were walking down Zubairi Street, a major street in Sana'a. My friend sort of bumped into a guy dressed in military fatigues, caught his jacket on the guy's gun, and the guy sort of stared at us. And then we went and we had breakfast, and when we walked out about 10 minutes later, this guy had another guy, and he went up to my friend and he said, he's speaking in Arabic, he said, "Who is this with you?" And they went through, and he said, is he a foreigner? And my friend said, yes, he's an American. And then they started pulling us to the car. And I'd talked to my fiance, my wife now at the time, about some of these things, because like Joel said, so much has changed. It's not what it once was. And so you knew that there was a chance of these kidnappings. And what is it that you do? Do you do what the German diplomat did and try to escape? Or do you do what Luke Summers did and go? And Luke was alive and the German wasn't. And as I realized that the kidnapping was happening, it was a busy street. There was 20, 25 Yemenis just standing around watching this happen. Two guys with guns pull us toward the taxi with its back door wide open. I couldn't get in the car, and so we resisted. And the guy dropped my friend's arm, and the guy who was holding my arm like this, they dropped my arm and chambered a bullet in the gun. And then right before, you know, there was a second where right before he shot, we stared at each other. I took off running. My friend took off running. And he never shot, and they got in the car and went away. But that's, you know, that's how these things work. Luke, you know, the German, they chased him down and they executed him. Me, I ran into a little restaurant on the street, and they didn't follow and they didn't shoot. Luke got in the car and he was alive for a while, and then there was a rescue attempt that U.S. Special Forces went in, and Luke was killed in that rescue attempt. And so, you know, these are three cases. And two of them died, and I didn't die. And there's really no rhyme or reason as to why it happened one way and didn't happen, because the actions were so similar.
Did you somehow feel betrayed by the place you had devoted yourself to so much?
Yeah, Yemen is. I think there's a sense of that because I'd been traveling there since 2003. This was in 2014. There were many Yemenis that I considered quite close friends. We talked a little bit about sort of the sense of vulnerability that the press card gives you. There's also a sense of vulnerability, or of invulnerability rather, when you go to a place that you know so well, and you're relying so much on the generosity of these people, and so many of them welcome you into their home. They take care of you. In fact, on that same trip, I was speaking with a sheikh, and he said, you know, I'm not going to let you leave my house without a bodyguard, because you'll get kidnapped. So he sent me with a tribal delegation of bodyguards that took me back to the place where I was staying. And so there are these things that happen, and you really do feel like, okay, this society has welcomed me and they are protecting me. And of course, in Arab society, you often hear, you know, these ahlan wa sahlan, you know, welcome, you're here, you're under my protection. But then in that moment, after the Arab Spring, when the rules have changed, on this very busy street, 20 Yemenis just watching one other Yemeni and an American be kidnapped and doing nothing, this has become, in Yemen, in Syria, in Iraq, in other places, this has just become normal. And when no one knows the rules, no one's willing to step out. So there was a a sense of betrayal, yeah, or at least a shattering of illusions that I'd held as someone who had traveled to this place, and to see it changing and changing so much for the worse was tough to take.
Would you go back?
I tried to go back earlier this year. It's we were talking before, and there are trips that you take before you're married, and there are things that you do after.
When you're pregnant.
When you're pregnant, when you're expecting,
you host,
yes.
Host panels in Manhattan.
So, I would like to at some point, but I don't think it'll be anytime soon.
I have to ask you one more question, completely off the grid. In homage to everything you've done on this story, can you tell us in the nutshell what's going on in Yemen? It would be wrong not to. I mean, it felt wrong not to ask. Just,
sure. So yeah, in a nutshell, it's an eight-sided civil war. The Saudis are bombing a Shia rebel group, which has taken over the government. The Saudis are under the impression that the rebel group is a proxy of Iran, which I don't buy. The U.S. is supporting Saudi Arabia bombing the Shia rebel group, which has opened up a great deal of room for Al-Qaeda and ISIS to take over territory. For quite a long time, you had the internationally recognized president who was in exile, the former overthrown president who was at home in Sana'a directing troops as well. And so it's become incredibly muddy, incredibly murky. The Saudis went in March with the idea that airstrikes would win the war in a couple of weeks. Now they've inserted ground troops. There's peace talks today in Switzerland. But there's really, much like the conflict in Syria, it's become so intractable that no one knows what a solution would look like anymore. Do the Saudis sort of back down and then allow the Houthis to declare victory, this Shia rebel group? Or do they continue to double down in the hope that eventually they'll be able to do more of what it is that they'll be doing, more bombing, and that will actually have different results than it's had over these past 9 months?
So an eight-sided civil war where there are now fewer journalists able to operate, less transparency and understanding, from there to Syria. And Therese, you have again assigned yourself to cover some of the most important stories of our time. And you've done it as a freelancer, cobbling together the equipment, the client, the outlet, all everything, your own safety. So how do you measure and do your best against that set of conditions to keep yourself safe?
I think the most important part of my safety has been the developments that we've seen with the organization that I helped to found, Frontline Freelance Register, and then our allies with the global safety principles that have been established this year. Starting in 2012, 80% of the coverage coming out of Syria was by Syrians or freelance journalists. And the climate at the time was one in which the Syrian government was targeting journalists, and one where the industry was backing off. So that meant they were trying to cut corners in terms of costs, in terms of expenses, in terms of all the things that guarantee and equate to our safety. So when our colleagues were kidnapped, early on a lot of journalists got together and started organizing ourselves, whether working with our allies, with aid organizations that were still operating in Syria, and each other, to share information, to share best practices, to share routes, equipment, etc. Then we were fortunate enough this year to have a lot of urgency from not only allies in our space who have been working with us the whole time, CPJ, Rory Peck Trust, Reporters Without Borders, but also the industry. And that's been the most important new partner in this, really talking about the pay structure and other safety standards that we really need as the industry transitions to a period where they're increasingly relying on contracted labor as opposed to staffers. So that's been my entire experience reporting in Syria, has been very much dictated by these kind of bigger dynamics in this changing industry, and it dictates my safety and the safety of my colleagues, whether international or Syrian, every day.
How did it change over the course of time? From what was it like for you reporting the first year versus the descent into what Syria is now?
Well, hearing Greg talk about the fate of three people, three reporters in Yemen, is very similar to my experience in Syria. I started reporting in the same month that my colleague Austin Tice was kidnapped, who remains in captivity, I was reporting very much in the way that, Joel, you spoke of coming up with stories. We had a lot of camaraderie with the Syrian opposition at the time. We were welcomed. They were happy to have journalists. They wanted to show what the Syrian government was doing, which was bombing schools, hospitals, as they do to this day. So so we were very much welcomed at first. I felt comfortable. Very soon we saw, as the political dynamics started to change at the international level, we saw greater mistrust of Westerners. We saw the desperation accumulating to a point where we became targets for kidnapping and crimes of desperation. So that changed in just a matter of a year. And I saw, I would say that my experience reporting in the same way that my colleagues who were then kidnapped is pretty powerful. But then to this day, unfortunately, while we are hoping, while we are really optimistic about the safety standards, a lot of those haven't been implemented yet. So we are very much reporting in the same conditions that led to the abduction of colleagues like James Foley.
I was going to ask you, how did you feel? What was your personal reaction when Jim Foley was killed?
To be honest, I didn't believe it, which sounds so naive, because I was very much aware of the inside dynamics of kidnapping, abduction, ransoms, all of the things that were happening, the information we were all trying to almost crowdsource to get more information on our missing colleagues for years. I was shocked by it, and then I think there was, you know, really a collective trauma in our space. I've talked with many colleagues, and I think the one-year anniversary, the past few months, has been really traumatic.
I think everyone in this room is extremely sensitive to what our local colleagues go through and our local journalists go through. At Syria Deeply, we work with most in-country, solely with Syrian journalists, and not one of our assignments, not one of our stories, but it seems worth mentioning now. Some Danish colleagues of ours were working with two journalists in ISIS-held territory, getting sort of a story that we'd all reported, but for the first time on film, really capturing how ISIS school systems work and what's being taught and what are the requirements for students showing up and young children who are forbidden from staying home, parents who are forbidden from homeschooling, what they go through, and they were recently beheaded. And there was a decision made not to use the story for what might happen to their families. And it does really involve and invoke this concept of an information blackout that ends up happening. Murder is the ultimate form of censorship. That's the CBJ's line, Joel. And it also echoes your book last year, The New Censorship. By their own standards, are the attackers succeeding? Are they effectively shutting out dissenting voices, holding back inquiries into what's really happening in the world? Do you think that by their own standards they are, this is effective, this is working?
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's irrefutable. I mean, censorship doesn't work in the way that it used to. It's not 100% effective, but it doesn't need to be. If you look at the censorship by violence that's taking place in Syria, for example, it's probably working at 90 to 95%. Certainly, stuff is getting out. Your network is getting stuff out. Citizen journalist collectives like Raqqa is being slaughtered silently. Have done amazing work, and I don't know if you know, but they lost another reporter today was killed. It's a terrible cost. And people always talk about this dynamic in Syria as if it's unique, but it's very similar. What's happening in Mexico, where I used to report, is actually very similar. There's tremendous censorship through violence, and it's very effective. It's so effective that we're at this point where we don't know what we don't know. We don't know the story that we're missing, and we kind of know we're missing the story in Syria. We know there's a lot happening there, and we're not being informed about it, but there are huge swaths in Mexico where the trafficking organizations are calling the shots and using these same kind of violent methods of kidnappings and executions, and they're so effective that we're not even aware of the censorship. And then you have governments are quite effective. Remember, it wasn't that long ago, I sort of called this, the internet utopians, who said, the internet, impossible to control or censor the internet. People, information must be free. And I don't mean to ridicule that, because to a certain extent, it is true. But one country has really challenged that notion, and it's China. And they're showing that there's an alternative reality in which, sometimes I call it just-in-time censorship. Not everything is censored in China. It's not North Korea. But if they identify certain kinds of information that they want to suppress, they have the technical resources to achieve that. And that's the reality in which we live today.
It's so interesting. I mean, so many of these countries use openly and comfortably this concept of the red lines, mm-hmm. conveniently moved around at will, and also what I've noticed, criminalizing so much that you're suddenly breaking the law.
Yeah. I think these moving red lines are what get journalists in trouble. I mean, that's why there are 49 journalists in jail in China. If you look at the recent spate of reporters who have been in prison, and I think this is highly relevant in a place like Bloomberg, they're business reporters. They're business reporters who were doing kind of routine stories on stock market manipulation that might have been tolerated a year ago. Now they're not tolerated because that line has moved. They've sort of been doing what they're doing, but they somehow missed this message that was not going to be acceptable anymore. You look at Egypt. Egypt is always, I think the concept of the red line was born in Egypt. It's so ingrained in the way reporters operate, but the red line shifted there, and journalists didn't quite, it shifted so quickly and so dramatically when Sisi came to power that journalists missed it. And the crackdown sort of continues, and that's why so many journalists are in jail there, or Turkey is another example. So these lines move, and when they move and local journalists don't anticipate or they aren't prepared, that's when these legal actions happen, and that's when you see the imprisonments rise.
Unless their arrest is the memo.
Sorry. Yes. Well, that's a good way to put it. I mean, it really is the red line. By virtue of the arrest, you move the red line. That's the message you're sending. It's very effective. It works.
I almost hesitate to ask about one specific case because he's an extremely close friend of mine, Jason Rezaian.
Yes.
By every reporter's account, doing fantastic work in Iran,
yeah.
observing what the basics of having a press card and what the lines were supposed to be for behavior, not for his reporting. Mm-hmm. I mean, what message do you think that sends?
Well, first of all, when I think about going back to my original point about the status that journalists had, I mean, Jason is a correspondent for the Washington Post. The Washington Post. No U.S. correspondent for any major publication has ever been jailed longer. I mean, they took the correspondent for the Washington Post and put him in jail in this arbitrary, unprecedented and unfathomable legal action. So it is a direct challenge to the media as an institution, because they're really just saying we will do whatever we want. We will do whatever we want, and the tactics. We've been involved in many cases in Iran, and we've raised the alarm, and we pounded the tables, and eventually these imprisonments become too costly, and for some reason we have not gotten to that point with Jason. And obviously the dynamic is very different with the nuclear negotiations and the internal power struggle, and that's a long conversation. But every time that I remember that he's in jail, I'm just astounded. I'm astounded that it's gone on this long, that it's been this arbitrary, this provocative, this deliberate, and honestly, I don't see a clear endpoint right now, and that concerns me greatly.
500 days plus.
Yeah, 500 days. 500 days.
Madam Ambassador, government's political will, without making you get specific to any government on the record, on camera, how do you deal with political will when it's at the government level that some of these decisions to hold or protect or not protect or attack are happening? There's no, it's like there's no grid. There's no, what do we turn to if not those who are supposed to be in control of a situation? Or how, let me ask it another way that might be more comfortable, which is, how do we square in this room, people who care about this issue, how do we wrap our heads around what they're supposed to be doing and how we get them to do it without citing any specific cases? Because this is, it's not going to happen without their participation.
That's exactly the problem. It will not happen without a political will, without their participation, and certainly at an international level. We have, I think, to continue creating the norms and the legislation with the hope that sooner or later, at least to some extent, in some parts of the world, this will be translated into, you know, action. But again, I think if you look at the situation that journalists are in, certainly it's a microcosm, it's a reflection of the broader problems of the society. You cannot expect a society which, you know, abuses its own populations, which ignores human rights, which is headed by autocrats, repressive leaders, and, you know, where basic rights and freedoms are considered to be secondary or insignificant or absolutely unimportant to human lives. You can't expect these governments to make sure, you know, that for some reason they single out the journalists and treat them in any different way than they treat their own citizens. And that's a, you know, a part of a much bigger picture, certainly, where the battle will continue and it will be a constant struggle, I think. And in a way, I believe, in spite of the realism of the situation, we know that things will not improve by any measure anytime soon. Things might deteriorate in specific situations. But we have to keep just reminding that the issue exists. And we have to keep creating that context. And what I like about what you're doing now with the journalists that I jailed, you know, you're sending names one after another, all day long, yeah. At least that's what I saw today, to remind that these people exist and they are in jail, and they're in jail for just simply doing their job. Nobody should be implicated for simply doing the job. It doesn't make any sense because, you know, otherwise the whole society will stop if we're all guilty for being who we are. For being human beings, being, I don't know, bakers, journalists, professors, it doesn't make sense. It just, creating that critical mass is very difficult, but I think it's very important. And I wish, you know, there was more of an attempt to really draw attention internationally, as you do, to the journalists who've been jailed, the journalists who've been killed, the very fact that you keep writing about it and in sending the information that 95% of the cases when journalists are killed, we have, you know, no trials, we have no perpetrators found, discovered. Even if these are found, it doesn't go to the sentence, which is an incredible degree of you know, abnormality, even in the context of, you know, the overall justice systems. It is something absolutely glaring. And again, I think we have to make noise about this at all possible levels. We have to make noise about, you know, the local journalists and local bloggers and local freelancers, again, because quite often, you know, Raqqa is being slaughtered silently. Fortunately, we know that name. But how many others are there like this who are doing the job and we don't even know the names? How many local journalists get killed? We don't even realize that they were killed. And it's, you know, again, it's some kind of lifeline for the local populations to know, you know, for the rest of the world to know what happened. So I think I don't see any quick solutions. I can see a role of regional organizations or United Nations in creating the normative base, in providing some sort of, you know, context where things can happen. And at least where I come from in Europe, you know, we have Council of Europe, which has certain sets of you know, normative base for protection of journalists. You have OEC, who does that. United Nations has this 2006 resolution, and now resolution of this year. The very fact that it's so hard to get a resolution done in the Security Council shows how complex the issue is, because we've had to wait for some 10 years to have a new text
adapted to the current situation where the local conditions have changed, where terrorism has become a problem, you know, in which still makes operation for journalists much more complicated, much more risky. And none of this has been reflected. And the very, when we took up the issue, you know, we were told, no, this will not fly, you can't get that through. In the end, we did get that through. But there's a degree of inbuilt skepticism. Why do we have to deal with that? Such a small number of, you know, there are millions of people being, you know, affected and hundreds of thousands killed, like in Syria, and why do you have to deal with 1,000 journalists who were killed? No, it's a level of cynicism that exists because, again, no, the more corrupt the society is, the more criminal the regimes, the less they want the transparency and you know, the world to know what's happening, and therefore it is an uncomfortable force in the middle, the journalists who are exposing what they're doing, and in that sense, I think, you know, there will never be a positive climate, but the pressure from you know, NGOs, from media groups, those who work on the ground, and I feel I think it's very important to just keep reminding that we will not let them, you know, go as, you know, easy as they want, that this issue will stay there on agenda, and that, you know, mustering more support from various ends, from various sides, in the civil society in particular, because again, it's a lifeline for the civil society. When free word is lost, the civil society is gone as well. So I think we have to just keep doing it, even though realistically we understand that it's just a very unequal battle.
I'm always impressed, humbled, encouraged, humbled at how much diplomats seem to draw from the open press the information they need to do their jobs, synthesize what's happening, formulate solutions. So what happens to our global system, to the solution fixing, when that information starts to disappear, like in Yemen or elsewhere? What are the stakes for the global system that way?
I do not imagine, you know, a global system where the information disappears, because I believe, frankly, the desperation of the people on the ground, the horrors that they go through, will always, particularly with the current technical capabilities, will always create an outlet at the risk of their lives. You know, if you think about Cesar report, you know, the 50,000 photos that were taken out of Syria of people tortured and killed, somebody didn't dare to do that. So there will always be an outlet to get that. The difficulty, I think, for us in terms of making informed judgments is, you know, to trust the outlets, because again, you have the information and you have some misinformation floating freely around on purpose, deliberately. And for somebody who, you know, who doesn't have their own ears and eyes on the ground, how to distinguish what's information, what's, you know, misleading and waylaying you and your judgments. And in that sense, again, the job of the journalist is so valuable and important that we have to make that effort. There are other sources, definitely. I mean, on Yemen, for example, we've been talking to Médecins Sans Frontières and others, you know, NGOs who are there. There's still people operating. So in that case, you know, you try to get as full a picture as possible to make sure that you know what you're doing and you know, again, you make the right judgments and you move things in the right direction. But as always, even moving the right making the right decisions doesn't depend, again, on the facts solely. It depends on political will, which runs back to the same issue. And in cases in Yemen, in cases in Syria, in South Sudan, whatever that is, Central African Republic, you know, I think we all know the facts. Sometimes, unfortunately, at the cost of the lives of those who report. But the problem is not knowing the facts. The problem is taking the right decisions on the basis of facts. And you know, all the best facts in the world will not guarantee that we take the right decisions. So it's again, I see this as a much bigger problem of political will at all levels than just one particular aspect.
Joel, you helped launch the global campaign against impunity, citing that, well, your organization, fair, with many colleagues and wonderful people, citing that 9 times out of 10, the killers of journalists go free. Just to wrap us up this evening, can you help us understand how does the campaign work and how is it going?
Well, how's it going? I mean, you know, it's going okay. But, you know, they're still killing journalists, so, you know, it doesn't give me tremendous satisfaction. But, I mean, I think, okay, but in all seriousness, I mean, let's go back to what the ambassador was saying. I mean, a decade ago when we launched this, it really wasn't on anyone's agenda. And even the word impunity was not, you know, being widely used. And we really launched this on the basis of our data, and that's, you know, one of the strengths of CPJ is we have teams with local knowledge and local language skills investigating each journalist killed, making determinations about why they're killed, whether it's for their work, tracking the investigation, determining whether there are convictions. And we were able to document that 90% of these cases, just as the ambassador mentioned, there was a complete impunity. And you know, in a handful of cases, you would see, you know, the gunman or whatever who carried out these crimes prosecuted, but almost never would you see complete justice, would you see the masterminds brought to justice. And of course, this creates a climate of self-censorship and information control. So how is the environment different today? First of all, this is a global issue. The UN is just one example. Has, you know, this has gotten onto the UN's agenda. There's an action plan to combat impunity that's spearheaded by UNESCO. There have been a number of debates at the level of the Security Council. There have been General Assembly resolutions. This is a key policy issue in terms of U.S. bilateral relations. It is on the agenda in many different countries in different national contexts, and we are seeing successful prosecutions. This year, we've actually had 5 convictions. That's an unprecedented number. It's so small when you consider the scale of the problem, but it's still larger than any year we've ever seen. We've had convictions in Nepal, we've had a couple of convictions in Brazil. In the last few years, we've even had convictions in Pakistan, in Russia, countries with terrible records of impunity. So, you know, I have to really take the long view. I have to take the long view, and I have to take some solace from the fact that the issue itself has risen on the international agenda, that there are people, allies in the international community, like the ambassador, who understand the importance of this issue and have taken it on. There are individuals within governments and even leadership in some governments that understand this issue, and we are seeing convictions. So, you know, that gives me some satisfaction, even when I look out over what I consider to be still a pretty bleak landscape.
Well, I hoped to have time for questions.
We do.
We do, okay.
And we actually have a microphone. So
oh, great.
We have probably like another 10 minutes or so for questions, then we can break for some coffee, and I know everyone will stick around. If you could just say your name, so we know who you are.
I'm going to say my name so I know who I am. David Michaels, I'm president of the Foreign Press Association. All of you are involved in different aspects of freedom of the press. I cannot, and I haven't tried to in any way compete with you, but I'm very, very involved in trying to provide journalists with the equipment and know-how of how to say, stay safe and communicate in a secure manner. We can teach journalists sometimes to practice correctly. The problem is, and I hope this is not going to become a surprise for any of you, journalists are not perfect. This may come as a shock to you all. We've briefed people, we've given them the equipment, and they're rather cavalier, and they get into trouble. Maybe that's part of the personality of a journalist. One comment. Secondly, is there seems to be, whenever a journalist gets into trouble, many forms of threats to that government to protect journalists. Don't you think that an approach might be wiser to try to inform and educate these governments that the benefits about the benefits of press freedoms. Might that be an approach rather than a threatening approach?
Is that a question for Joel specifically?
It is.
Well, I mean, just to give you an example, I've sat down with the leadership of Turkey. I've sat down with President Erdogan and Prime Minister Davutoglu. We've had meetings with Foreign Minister of Egypt. I've met with leadership in Mexico. I've met with the President of Pakistan. I talked to them. It's not like all we're doing is throwing bombs. We're talking, and sometimes the leadership even understands the implications. But these are societies that are threatened by information. Or there are forces within the society, sometimes operating outside the control of central authority, that's threatened by information. It's always a question of both. You want dialogue, but you also want there should be a political cost for their actions, and it's our job to make sure they pay it. I mean, I don't know how, and sometimes governments are willing to pay it, often they're willing to pay it, but that is my job to make sure that that cost, that they pay that cost, and I do everything I can to ensure that, but I always want to maintain channels for dialogue. Talking about information and data security, and I think we have colleagues who are probably better positioned to talk about that. It is a big challenge. But again, I think it's very important that you look at broadly at this media ecosystem that I talked about. So if you are a major media organization and you have the ability to implement best practices within your own organization and enforce them, that's one thing. If you're talking about freelancers who are interacting with multiple media organizations and multiple sources and have different ways of operating in different environments, then of course it's more difficult. If you're talking about local journalists and citizen journalists, so the information environment is so complex, and there isn't one size fits all solutions. You really have to look at these different populations and develop strategies that work for each of them.
You ever feel like Don Quixote?
No.
That's good. Perfect. We have a question over here.
My name is Sonia Fry. I'm the retired director of the Overseas Press Club. What happened to the concept at the UN that killing a journalist would be a war crime? I understand really that passed, but I don't hear anything about it after that.
I mean, I can, you probably have more knowledge
about it. The issue was when we were negotiating resolution, certainly one of the points that we put into resolution was basically referring to the Rome Statute, the ICC, and possibility of war, being treated as a war crime. Certainly that was discussed. But again, there's always, from how I see things, there's always a gap between the legal, the normative base, and the implementation. And having perfect norms or inscription of a phrase into the text doesn't mean that this will be translated in practical reality. Certainly, there has to be much greater, progress on implementation side. I think the UN has created so many good norms, again, UNESCO as well, as I referred to. The question is not having more norms or more descriptions, because if you take international humanitarian law, human rights law, whatever you take, it's so easy to define the crimes against journalists. It's obvious. The question is, does a government care for these norms and the laws? Couldn't care less. And for governments who don't care for human rights as a whole, you can't expect that government, or where rule of law is weak, where governance is weak, you can't expect that, again, one particular aspect of rule of law will function very well, because it's part of the bigger picture. And therefore, I think, again, in a context, if we want this to work, if we want to put an end to impunity and to make sure that laws prevail, I think there has to be a much bigger push as a whole towards strengthening the rule of law in societies as a whole. Because it cannot work in bits and pieces. It has to be part of the whole. And unfortunately, rule of law, again, is not a very popular concept in the United Nations. We have a whole range of countries which will, the minute you start talking about rule of law, have quite an uncomfortable feeling. So it's again, yes, it's in there, but you know, implementation is quite a different thing than the letter.
Joel, you want to weigh in?
Yeah, I'm going to add to that. First of all, journalists are civilians. They're defined as civilians under international humanitarian law. Deliberately targeting journalists is a war crime because they are civilians. That status is reaffirmed in international humanitarian law. But think about the challenge you get into, and we've been in discussions, if you had a special designation for journalists in the Rome Statute, you'd have to have a definition, okay? Do you want to define journalists in this current context? If you do that, you will be empowering governments to say, oh, there's an internationally codified definition of journalists, you're a journalist, and you're not. Believe me, the Russians would have a field. They would love that, because then they could pass all sorts of national laws excluding people who didn't fit this international definition from you know, certain protections. And what would we gain from that? Do you think governments, you know, if this, since journalists are already protected as civilians, if you had a special designation for journalists, I would argue that would not make them safer for the reasons the ambassador mentioned, and it would empower repressive governments. So I actually don't think that you want a specific designation of journalists as war crimes. What you want to do is enforce existing international humanitarian law, which already makes the killing of a journalist a war crime because of their civilian status.
But if I may come back to something else, which is not directly linked to the law, but the initiative of having a special representative or special rapporteur of the Secretary General on the protection of journalists, it's not in there yet, but there's, you know, again, from the non-governmental side, a movement to really call and engage more countries at the United Nations so that this initiative is supported. And certainly, I think that can be done. We have to muster enough, you know, countries in support of that, so that there is a much bigger level of pressure towards the Secretary General. But I think that's a way to go. How much time that could take, how much time, you know, it will take, I cannot tell. But I think, you know, trying to have this new initiative, because that will allow a special focus on the protection of journalists among all the various issues that are there, I think that could be an option to go ahead.
First of all, kudos to Anna and Joel for your work on defending journalists. When I was started covering war zones, there was nowhere to turn, so it's just wonderful to have those outlets. Ambassador, I got a
question. Introduce yourself?
I'm sorry?
Introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Jonathan Wachtel. I'm with Fox News, and I covered a lot of war zones working for Fox, ABC News, and Worldwide Television News over the last couple of decades. Ambassador, is part of the problem that maybe there aren't enough meetings on the issue at the UN? I mean, it's wonderful that you've championed this, and it's wonderful to have an idea of a special rapporteur or whoever it would be who would be designated to follow this. But doesn't the Security Council need to be engaged on this on a regular basis, perhaps a committee that would meet every 3 months, 4 months, whatever, review this and name and shame governments that are failing to comply?
Security Council is made up of member states, and you know, you will always find at least a couple of permanent members who will not be happy with the idea, and some of the non-permanent members, and certainly some of the incoming non-permanent members, will be among those that you mentioned earlier today. So I can't realistically see how it can, you know, if Security Council was something, you know, an abstract body high above doing what the charter expects them to do, that would be a different story, perhaps, in the real world. Certainly, you cannot expect that to happen. And then I think the very fact, you know, the very frequency of meetings doesn't mean that there'll be an impact or a result. On some of the issues like Syria, you know, we meet 3 times per month. How we resolve Syria's situation? I'm not sure. We've been watching deteriorate in front of our eyes while we were discussing things. So, you know, it's not a frequency of meetings. It's the, again, the political will. And the political will does not arise from, you know, the numbers. It's something much deeper, which, you know, comes from how we perceive ourselves as societies and which side of, you know, the line democracy and everything else on the other side, you know, whichever way we stand in, you know, in terms of how we position ourselves as state. If we can't care less about, you know, the fundamental rights, the basic rights, including the freedom of expression, how to expect that member of the Security Council to defend, you know, the journalist if you know, if he's happy to have, you know, suppression of free thought and suppression of free, you know, right to information. Those who can't stand the right to information will never defend a journalist. That's for sure.
Hi, I'm Alan Dodds-Frank. I'm a former president of the Overseas Press Club and a former employee of Bloomberg, et cetera, et cetera. my question to the whole panel, maybe starting with Greg and working our way down, is how can we inject the issue of impunity for killing journalists into the presidential candidates' debates?
Yeah, so, I mean, obviously there have been Americans killed. Lawrence Wright wrote a fantastic story in The New Yorker about the five hostages, I think it was entitled. You know, as Joel rightly says, these are American citizens. And at a time, I mean, last night we just saw a Republican debate on national security. These are wars happening that should be coming at us with a shout, and we're hearing them as a whisper in cases like Yemen, because there aren't any journalists there, and the ones who are there have been killed or have been killed in Syria and in Iraq.
I guess to continue on that, I would say, you know, back to our basic principles of an informed democracy and having information on decisions of war and peace. Before, when you spoke a little bit about what it looks like when you don't have journalists, I'll give an example from Syria from 2013 when Assad first crossed the red line by using chemical weapons. Earlier, it was July of 2013 when something like over 10 journalists were abducted that month. So by August, our members, our organization, we said to our members, like, responsibly, you cannot go in without a media organization backing you, and we can't stand by you if you decide to go in at this point. Later that month, most of the major news organizations had pulled out, and by the time the chemical weapons were used, there were not foreign journalists reporting inside, and many were that remained were Syrian activists who were reporting. So as Obama called Congress to make a decision about going to war, we didn't really have a lot of independent information coming out of Syria. So again, we were making decisions on going to war without a lot of independent information. So I think that's one example that was very powerful for me to see what the stakes that we have here without having independent information. But we're going to have that in any country where journalism is a crime.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a pretty simple way to get it on the agenda, Alan, and that's that they need to hire you to moderate the next Republican. You can ask the question.
But, I'm going to write you a joke.
Yeah, short of that, I don't think it's going to happen. I mean, bad news for you. To me, anyway, even as someone who advocates on this issue, it's understandable that it's not an issue. In a political debate, you know, when journalists ask these questions, there's always a perception, and even journalists are sensitive to this, you know. You can't be so self-referential if it's perceived that journalists are just pleading their own cause, you know, that can actually backfire. So I think in the terms of political debate, it's difficult, but I can tell you that for policymakers, there you really do have some leverage, and you do have some arguments that you can make. In terms of, and I've had, you know, many meetings and interactions both at the State Department and at the White House with Paul and the members of Congress with individuals who are aware of the importance of this issue and are concerned about it. So I think once you're in a policymaking role, then there's a lot more effective arguments you can make. I think it's very difficult to try and introduce it into the campaign, but that's just my view.
This is going to be the last question. So here goes.
Hi, Chris Lawton, I'm a security advisor here at Bloomberg. Gregory, you mentioned in Yemen you have the support of BuzzFeed and the resources they were able to give to you. And Anna, I know you've been working on the global safety principles and that side of things. And it strikes me that in most cases, there is something that can be done for most people, be that a local journalist or freelancer working in Syria, even if that's around information protection, and how they communicate right through to someone deploying here from Bloomberg to go and cover something in a particular part of the world. Now the key problem, it seems to me, is cost. Because for BuzzFeed to resource someone like you, Gregory, or for someone from another news organization, it takes time. It might even take an advisor working very hard to get FaceTime with that journalist and actually making sure they speak to them directly. Because as you mentioned from the Foreign Press Association, some people don't even want to hear it. And in the conflicts which we look at in the countries in which we often are forced to look at, they have to. But that takes time and it takes effort. And the key aspect, it seems to me, which we haven't really mentioned thus far, is cost and where that resource has come from. Because the capability is out there, but it's paying for it and getting it to the people who need it most, who typically have the least money. Now, I'm wondering if there's any sort of vision or ideas from anywhere on the panel about how that question could be resolved.
I'll say one thing about one of the most optimistic parts about the global safety principles, I think, has been that we are really pooling the resources, but also understanding sometimes, I would say, examples about news organizations that weren't paying on time, that weren't paying expenses in advance, just poor practices. And news organizations were saying, like, that's just how it's always been. Mm-hmm. But now that we have this community, we can say, actually, no, this news organization does pay on time, does have these things, and does provide, has limited resources, but somehow makes the capacity for these things because it's a priority. So because we can kind of now have this group conversation, we're able to prove that it's not impossible to have higher standards. So I would say that's one point of opportunity that I think we're seeing in our space, but of course, budgets are our biggest enemy in terms of freelance safety, and I foresee it to continue to be a problem.
And there's, if I could just add to that, you know, when you go to these places, it's about attempting to manage risk. We can't avoid risk completely, or we wouldn't be there. And so we want to limit risk. And yes, you're right. We keep adding layers and layers and layers of security. We don't always implement it perfectly as journalists, certainly. Some of us don't even like it. We feel that it's an imposition upon us. It gets in the way of us trying to tell the story. So all of these things are there, but also, on the cost issue, you know, organizations like Sebastian Junger's, where you're giving just sort of the minimal first aid and some of the other things that you face, and having discussions, having these courses that run for 4 or 5 days. I know I went through one with BuzzFeed. They're relatively low cost, and freelancers can attend many of these for free, at least with Sebastian Junger's organization. So while it's not perfect security, it certainly does a lot, I think, at a low level of cost, that's able to equip freelancers who are going into the field, equip people like myself who are going there. It's not perfect security, of course, but it does, I think, manage a lot of the risk that you're going to take. And just even talking through the process prior to going with someone, even thinking through some of these situations, I think helps you to be a little bit more prepared, a little less shocked, so that there's some muscle memory that you start to rely on in these cases. And that's something that, while it's a baseline, is something I think that as Anna said, is changing, and that can provide at least some way to manage and limit the risk.
I just have one last point. I mean, the other thing that's out there is information. I mean, in many of these environments, it is the information and the knowledge that keeps you safe. It's information about best practices, it's information about conditions on the ground, and there are inexpensive ways to ensure that the information reaches the people it needs to reach, and isn't just, for example, isolated within well-funded and media news organizations, that it reaches others who are maybe outside that community but would benefit. And so we're looking at strategies that would help do that. You know, part of it involves creating communities, part of it involves creating trust, part of it involves creating mechanisms that would allow the information to reach the people who most need it. Rob Marney, CPJ Deputy Executive Director, who's here, is leading our efforts internally to try and figure out solutions to this. And that's something we're really focused on, because that, we think, is the most cost-effective way of spreading these practices around and increasing the safety of all of those who are involved in information gathering in this new information order.
Let me just make one point as an impact there. I think we've seen a lot of major news outlets take a step back and say that we're going to solve this, so to speak, by not encouraging freelancers or not using their work. And I think it's a fallacy and it's completely unfair, because at the end of the day, they still benefit from the passing of that video from one hand to the other. Everything that's happening in the current system that's imperiling journalists in the current system, we are all stakeholders in. So what Joel and his colleagues are doing and what Anna's trying to set up, I think, is a moral responsibility for those in the mainstream press to get involved and to help resource in some shape or function.
I think that's going to be the final word. Thanks to our Joel and Teresa, Gregory, and to Laura for her, we are indeed all stakeholders, to your really elegant moderation of this panel. Thanks as well, of course, to the OPC and to the Ford Motor Company for their impeccable support of this really important issue for all of us. And to Brian, who I've spoken to more than my husband. And so Brian, on behalf of Mr. Reinhardt, his deepest thanks. Again, this is a really important conversation. There's so many truly, truly, truly wonderful people in this room who are really smart, really passionate, have great ideas. Please stay, have some coffee, have a little sweet bite to eat, swap names around, swap cards, and until we do this again, have a blessed holiday season. Thank you.